Good morning, everyone. Let's stand and sing the chorus. Something beautiful. Number 488, He Keeps Me Singing. On the second verse, let's get around and greet one another.
Oh, morning. I have quite a few things, so get comfy. The ladies' party will be this Tuesday at 6 o'clock. If you want to participate in the gift exchange, please bring a gift for that. The senior food box will be this Wednesday, if anybody can come out and help with that. We will have choir practice today at 3:30. And our service tonight, instead of being at 6, will be at 5 o'clock. There will be a special film that you will absolutely enjoy. Our Christmas cantata is coming up. It will be on Christmas Day. This was a big hit last year, and I hope you all come out. Please be in prayer for that mainly. We've had some sick people. We've had some people out, and we need your prayers. We have a letter from missionary Bill Finch, and I'm just going to read it because it's not that long. Dear church, pastor, and friends, it has been a blessed year. Our health continues to hold, for which we praise his name. I am still teaching the adult Sunday school class and still enjoy it. I took a break when Pastor Reinhardt taught a special series on Ezra. That was very interesting. I am still doing home Bible study with a shut-in couple. Right now they both have COVID. We have two students for this semester. One or both will return to us in January, we hope. We also continue with prime timers. Most of us have played popcorn being sick, much like our own church. We run about 14 to 16 when everyone can make it. We are going caroling in a couple of weeks. We make up bags and baskets for those we carol to. We all seem to enjoy it to the fullest. A prayer request is that they sent another African pastor on to glory. He was a precious friend. The churches in Kenya needing comfort and grace. A wonderful celebration of our Savior's birthday for all. So please be in prayer for them. There are always missionary letters back there on the back table. If you want to go and grab them and read them, they are very enjoyable. I think that's all I have.
Hymn number 125, Joy to the World. Make sure you watch the screen on these Christmas songs, because some of the words are different. Some of the spelling are different. Chris learned this morning that Noel is N-O-W-E-L-L. Folks, I've got a lump in my throat. Will not leave. Hymn number 136, The First Noel.
Oh, Thank you guys for that. In a Charlie Brown Christmas, Charlie Brown was having trouble getting into the Christmas spirit. So Linus said, "Charlie Brown, you're the only person I know who can take a wonderful season like Christmas and turn it into a problem." Isn't that what we do? Instead of it being one of the most glorious times of our year, a lot of us dread this season because the busyness of it, it amps up parties and places that you are required to be. Instead of just enjoying this time of year, we seem to come to it in a time of dread, and we kind of turn it into a problem. Instead of allowing Christmas to be a problem, how about we allow Christmas to be the solution? Because we understand that certainly that is. So that's what we're going to be looking at this morning. Last week we began a brief series of messages called The Scenes of Christmas. And this morning we will notice scene number two of Christmas. Now, it is familiar and I understand that. And sometimes when you cover a familiar story, sometimes people have a tendency to zone out. But if you want to zone out, how about you do that on your time and not on God's time? So let's just enjoy what we have here this morning and let's just learn a little bit about this particular scene of Christmas. Now we know this, that it goes without saying that our Lord became a man and He changed history. But one of the most remarkable aspects of the Christmas story is this. So I started looking at it in maybe, I hope, in a new and a fresh way. But how many of you have heard about couples that are expecting a new child? And the big rave today is gender reveal. Have you heard about that? So these couples are inventing kind of new ways to declare what they're going to be having, whether it's a boy or girl. We understand that. So they go to this elaborate means just to be able to tell the world in which what child they're going to have. So we understand that. So we see all of that. Can you imagine if Jesus did a gender reveal? God the Father. But He did it. He did so. And we're going to be talking about that. But one of the things that I started thinking about as you break down the Christmas story and you look at every individual aspect of that story, how one event in my mind just stood out, and I hope I can convey it to you to where you start thinking about it in a brand new way. Now, when Jesus was certainly to be born, you all know the story, but some of the backstory of this was that who the first people that were privileged to hear the birth announcement, the gender reveal. Who was the first people that got to hear this? Now, if you and I were to write this story, we would not write these people would be the ones who would be entitled to hear it first. Now, we would think, or come on with me, we would think that the Savior of the world to be born, we ought to be able to broadcast that in a way that maybe everybody could hear it, or maybe we would think, since this is the very God of creation, certainly the God of creation should be able to reveal His true identity to those influential leaders of that day. Who would be the first to be able to hear that Jesus was to be born? Now, it started me on a journey of thinking this. You and I, if we had the opportunity to pen this story, we might want to take it in a different way. But I am so glad that the Bible records for us of what it does. Because how you're going to learn this story again, I think will hope make you appreciate it that much more. I'm going to ask you if you would to stand with me. And we'll look at something. This is not our text verse, all right? This is not our text verse. You get this for free this morning, all right? So this is just free for you. But I wanted to show you something in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 27. How God does things. Watch. But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. So about the time you start figuring out how God ought to work, is usually the way that He's not going to work. You see, because you can't put God in a particular vacuum and say, only God can do this. We understand from that verse that God can do all kinds of things, and He can even confound the mighty. He can do things with the weak. He can do things however He chooses to do. And in this story this morning, that is exactly what He chose to do. Father, we thank You for the opportunity to come and convey Your truth. And Lord, what a truth it is. Lord, as we start thinking about, as we are inching our way closer to that Christmas morn, as our minds and our hearts get closer and closer to that grand event of the world celebration, Father, I pray that we'll take out some time, even in this service, to enjoy what You have done for us as a person, collectively, as a city, and Lord, even as a nation. I certainly realize, Lord, that the older we get of our society, the more we're turning our back on You. But Father, just because the world wants to turn their back on You does not mean that we as a church have to follow that suit. Father, we can still say triumphantly that Jesus did come. He was born of a virgin. He did bear our sins on Calvary, and He did offer us eternal life through the blood of Jesus Christ. We understand that. And Father, we don't make no apologies for that here at this church. Father, we proudly proclaim the death, the burial, and the resurrection of our Savior. Father, I just pray that in this moment, in this time, that we can push aside those parties, those plans, those launch engagements, those all the next week's activities. And Father, I pray that we can focus just for a few minutes about our Lord and our Savior. Father, You deserve that. And we ought to be open to that. Father, for everyone that is assembled in this room, I pray a special blessing. For those, Lord, that are sick and afflicted and they cannot be here, I pray for them. Father, for those that are watching on Facebook, Lord, I pray that You would just equip them to be still and hear the message wherever they are hearing this from. But Father, we just pray that our hearts are open. We'll be attentive. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. If you were to send announcements for Jesus' birth, then this group of people would not have been included. These characters would have never made the who's who's of the most influential list of Bethlehem. Their story is truly amazing because of this. No Jewish child ever dreamed of growing up to be a shepherd. These men were considered, listen to me, wait a minute, are you ready? I need to know you're on tune with me. The shepherds were considered illiterate, they were considered uneducated, and they were considered social outcasts of their day. They were considered the lowest rung of the social ladder. And get this, talking about shepherds. Their testimony wasn't even admissible in a Hebrew court of law. So to find out how despised these shepherds were, you couldn't even call them as a witness in court. Nobody cared about who they was. Nobody cared about what they had to say. And so the remarkable fact is, or come on with me, come on. The remarkable fact is, Jesus chose these men to hear the first time the birth of the Lord Jesus. It's amazing. It's absolutely amazing. Because of their dealings with animals and Gentiles, their work on the Sabbath, they were often considered unclean men, and they were not even allowed to enter into the temple. The expression, dumb as sheep, have you ever heard that expression? they would have certainly included dumb as shepherds. In the world's eyes, these uneducated men should not have been the ones to receive the greatest announcement in human history. In a field outside of Bethlehem, the greatest news came to the very least of society. Are you listening to me? To the very least of society. Now, why didn't Jesus open up the Caesar's palaces, the king's palace, and says, "Look, here is a Christ child"? Why in the world would he go and have enough nerve to go to the shepherds of all people? They were considered illiterate. They were considered as unclean. They couldn't even come into the temple. They were despised. And yet Jesus decided they're going to hear the news first. To hear the news first, wait a minute, Lord, couldn't you have done it a little bit better than that? Yes. Couldn't he have chosen a better group of people to hear the first news of the birth? Yes. Did he do so? No. Did he come to the shepherd first? Yes. And as you will discover, that just means there's hope for us. Because if you ever thought that you was unimportant, if you ever thought that you did not matter, then you ought to appreciate this story, because the very people of society that did not matter, it seems like to me Christ is the one who elevated them the most. Can I give you a proof text? In that society, women and shepherds were usually in the same class of people. They were considered unreliable as witnesses. They were considered to be seen and not heard. But here in this story, and as you look at this of the Bible, Jesus elevated even the women of his society who he spoke with, and he even elevated the shepherds. It just makes me think that Jesus loves those that are unlovable. Jesus came to die for those that we would think has no future and no hope. You see, Jesus looked down from his heavenly estate, and he saw the shepherds, and quite frankly, listen to me, he saw you. You see, there's nothing that we could offer the king. There's nothing of our own life that we could offer Jesus that would matter anything. But yet, he came down for us so that you and I could go up to him. Listen to me. He came down to us so that we could go to him. There could be no other way. You see, he paid our price in full, and he came as one of the most humble beginnings that could ever be, that of a babe. Now, consider, if you will, that of Micah, the Old Testament prophet Micah, what he had to say. It's interesting, before I get there, why did he come to be born in Bethlehem, by the way? That's a question that's often asked. Why Bethlehem? Bethlehem is about 5 miles southwest of Jerusalem, located on the main highway from Jerusalem to Egypt. Its name came from the grain produced in the Old Testament days, for its meaning of Bethlehem was the house of bread. When we understand that Jesus called himself the bread of life. Do you remember that story? So we understand that. Micah chapter 5 and verse number 2 says this, "But thou, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though thou be little among thousands." Look at this. In those times, Bethlehem was nothing. It's just a small habitat there. It had nothing to offer. But the Bible says, though be little among the thousands of Judah, watch this, yet out of thee shall come forth unto me that is to be, watch, the ruler in Israel, whose going forth have been from old, from everlasting. Something that you might not know about Bethlehem was this. The people of that region considered Bethlehem just a little hamlet, just a little insignificant place. They considered, watch this, they considered Bethlehem nothing but a little trash heap. Jesus came to be born at that particular place. Are you with me so far? Angels brought the good news to these lowly, forgotten characters near an obscure town. Notice Luke chapter 2. Here's our text verses, and we'll get on. Luke chapter 2, verse number 8, if you will. I know you know this story, but just follow it like you've hearing it for the first time. Luke chapter 2 and verse number 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field. Now here's what they were doing. Keeping watch over their flocks. Look at this. They were on the night shift. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, the shepherds. Now watch what happened. And the glory of the Lord shone around about them. And they were sore afraid. But why was this information given to these outcasts? These shepherds received good tidings of great joy, but their reactions was not great joy. I know you're sleepy. One more time. The announcement was great joy, but they didn't have great joy. The Bible says they were in fear. Why? Because they were on the graveyard shift. If you ever worked a graveyard shift, there's not much fun about that. I can attest to that. We did our share of that early on, so I get that. The graveyard shift, here's what you're thinking. As soon as it's morning time, this shift will be over and I can go home. These shepherds were out in the field and all of a sudden, maybe the sheep are resting or maybe the shepherds are lying at the head of the sheep so they would not go over or whatever the case may be. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the heavens light up and the angels start singing and they start telling them some information. And I don't know about you, but that would be a very scary sight. Now, we read the story. It said it was great joy to the shepherds. They were in great fear. Why were they in fear? Because the very least thing they ever expected was the very announcement of the Lord Jesus Christ to be born to them. You see, can I tell you this? To this group of men who could not even go into the temple, this group of men whose testimony in court would not even be validated, these group of men who were shunned because of who they hung around with, these are the men that God chose to hear the first good news of the birth. It's an incredible story. It's an incredible story of hope. Hope for you and I that we are never outside of the Lord's care. The shepherds were scared to death. These outcasts were about to begin a new life, a life of purpose found in the child of promise. It was a humble town. The shepherds would come face to face with this babe where they found him. And think of it this way. In the blinking of an eye, they went from counting sheep. Now they were watching an angelic choir in the sky. Now, here's what you're thinking. I know. Stay with me. Here's what you're thinking. So what? Big deal. I've heard that all my life. I understand that. But I want you to picture this scene in the mind's eye. It's sleepy. It's dark. There's no light. And if they were to count sheep, they would have probably had to go to each one because there's hardly any night sky light. And all of a sudden, it is illumined like a noonday sun. And they start hearing things and seeing things that's beyond imagination. They had to be stunned beyond belief. If they were to even try to talk, the tongue at the roof of their mouth would be stuck. Why? It's because they've just seen something and heard something that was indescribable. Let me relate that for you. That's how it ought to be with our salvation. You see, our salvation is something that are to be so special. I don't know where you were when Jesus entered your heart, but can I challenge you this? Whether you was at a church at an old-fashioned altar, or whether you was home gathered by a radio or a television broadcast, or whether your parents led you to the saving knowledge of Christ, I can tell you, you are to be as spellbounded by Christ today more than you were when you got saved. Why? Here's the reason why, is because you know more now than you did then. And your relationship with Jesus ought to be so much more special than it was there. Now listen to me, listen. Maybe the night sky did not light up for you. And maybe you didn't hear angelic voices singing out in your way. But can I tell you this? I can tell you when I got saved, it was radically different for my life. Because I can tell you what Jesus did for me. No, I didn't hear angelic voices. No, I didn't hear the voice of angels singing. But in my soul and in my spirit, I knew that I was on a new walk with Christ. And watch this, nothing would ever be the same again. Is anybody listening this morning? That ought to be you. That ought to describe your salvation experience. You listen, you are to love Christ more now than you did then. It's not time to get lazy. It's not time to get complacent. Preacher, I've heard this story all my life. I know you have, but it's time to rejoice in the good news that Jesus has come for you. Let me tell you this. Here's what I know. He didn't have to. He volunteered. God the Father, who will go down to earth and redeem these creatures? I would imagine the seraphims and cherubims in heaven probably did like this. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. And maybe there was some discussion in heaven, but I just have a way in my own mind thinking that God the Son simply looked at His Father and said, I'll go. I'll go, but I know the price that it's going to take. I know what it's going to do. And even though it's going to be great, and even though it's going to take my very lifeblood, and even though I'm going to have to die on that old rugged cross, I'm going to be spit on, I'm going to be pugilized, I'm going to be whipped as a man could never even be recognized, he was so whipped. But he said, and then he said this, God the Father, why don't you let the first announcement be to shepherds? And maybe the angels of heaven did something like this. Ooh? What? To shepherds? No! You're the King. You're the God. You're the God that created everything. What do you mean to shepherds? Maybe Jesus said, they need to know. Because I'm going to come and I'm going to be their great shepherd. Because every sheep that will ever come to me, I will lose not one. Wow. That's the reason Jesus would come to the shepherds, because He knew how to identify with them. The Bible says in verse number 13 of Luke 2, and suddenly, I like that word, and suddenly there was an angel of multitude. What? How many is a multitude? We don't know. When we get to glory, maybe they'll explain that, or maybe it probably won't matter then, but the Bible says, a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God. And look what they even told us what they said. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. The same glory that sent them to the ground in the field sent them to the knees in the stable. They beheld the Lamb of God. From that moment on, these lowly shepherds would never, ever be the same. Somebody amen that. They would never be the same. How could they? How could they be the same of what they just seen? Verse number 10 says, and the angel said unto them, here's what he says. Here's what the angel says. Fear not, I bring you good tidings of great joy. I like that. Which shall be to all people. For unto you is born, watch this. You know this verse. Would you read this for me on the screen? If you got eyes, look up here at the top. Read this for me. For unto you is born this... Come on. In the city of David, a Savior. That was their news. There are three titles given to that babe. Number one is Savior. The Savior means deliverer. The word Christ means anointed one. And the word Lord means to be master. Of all the places a Savior could be born, why the manger? Verse number 12 says, You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Shepherds, mangers, why? Caring for animals was the way of life for these shepherds. Maybe some of their own animals might have even eaten from that same feeding trough that Jesus was laid in. I don't know about you, but the King of Glory was wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a common place. Now, wait a minute. Wait. I know you're sleepy. Wait a minute. He was in a common place because He came for common men. That just means that everybody that hears the gospel message can come unto Him and ask Him for their personal Savior. Wow. The sinful, rough, and hard-working shepherds were now bowing before the Lamb of God. Listen to this. They had nothing to offer this Christ child. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. Are you still with me? Say amen. They had nothing to offer the Christ child. They went to see this Christ child. And as they saw the heavens light up, what do you think they must have thought? What in the world could we... Come on with me. What in the world could we give to the babe? They had nothing. What do you give to Jesus? I'll answer that for you. Here's what He wants. He wants your heart. The greatest gift you can give to the Christ child is simply bow and acknowledge Him as Lord and Savior and Master. Lord, You are my deliverer. You are the anointed one. And Lord, You are my Master. You are who too we bow to this morning. You see, this is what they could give to the Christ child. And you know, that message of all those years ago is the same thing that works today. He still will receive your very own heart. I love that. Verse number 15, I love this. And it came to pass as the angels were gone away. Now watch this. The shepherds said one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing which shall come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us." Now that statement don't probably get any amens from you, but can I tell you this? Here's what they says. We got to hear this heavenly announcement. He made it for us. Let's go see what all of this is about. And I love this. The shepherds were in a hurry. And the Bible records these words. They came with haste. You know, the thing about the Christ child is this. Don't wait to come to Him. Come to Him while you can, right now, this very moment. You that are watching Facebook, don't wait to call upon the name of the Lord. You do it right now, right when you have the ability to do so. Because here's what we know. Life is uncertain. You may never get another chance and another opportunity. The call of Christmas is this. Waste no time. Look at verse number 20. And the shepherds returned. I like this. They saw Jesus glorifying and praising God. Look. For all the things that they had heard, not only heard, but seen, as it was told them. They were considered the very least of the least, but they were first to witness the birth of Jesus. The shepherds did not miss the real meaning of Christmas. They went from abiding in their fields to now abiding in Christ. Did anybody hear that? They were abiding in fields, now they were abiding in Christ. For they truly experienced the good news. The world needs to be made aware of this often. But can I show you something that as we finish up this morning, and it's this. Turn, if you will, to Matthew chapter 25 and verse number 44. Matthew chapter 25 and verse number 44. How does this fit into Christmas? I'll show you. Then shall they answer Him, saying, Lord, when saw we a hungered or a thirst or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not minister unto thee? That's a question. And then shall He answer them saying, truly or verily I say unto you, for as much as you did it, watch, not to one of the least of these, you did it not unto me. You see what He says this? Our message is not just to the elite. Our message is to those that have no hope. Our message is to those that feel like they are insignificant. The message of the gospel is interesting because let me just tell you this. There's a list of lowly people that Jesus came to in the Bible. Watch. Number one, they came to the lowly shepherds. Who in the world? Why would Jesus do that? Only He could answer that. He came to the lowly shepherds. Number two, He came to the uneducated fishermen. Wow. Listen, these fishermen was nothing but hardworking men, calloused men. All they knew was cast that net time after time after time. They worked hard for their living. Jesus came for the hard workers. Look at this. To the tax collectors, you got to be kidding me. Why would anybody love the tax collectors? It came to Jesus. Why? Matthew, one of the disciples, guess what he was? He was an IRS guy. And Jesus loved him. I like this. Jesus even loved the poor. How many of you can sympathize with that? What about number five? He came to the lepers, the lame, the blind, and the deaf. You know what's significant about that? It's because the religious people of their day forgot those people. They didn't want nothing to do with them. See, Jesus came on the scene and He educated, He brought a purpose to the shepherds, and then He brought purpose to those that no one else wanted. Can I tell you this? Who in their right mind would have ever, in their right mind, ever would have touched a leper? Come on with me. Nobody else would have, but Jesus did. Who in the world cared about the lame and the deaf and all of it, but Jesus did? Look at number six. What about this? Hey, this is a big one. The Samaritans. Wait, Jews and Samaritans were not exactly friends. Jews and Samaritans were not exactly going out and fellowship kind of people. Look at this. The Samaritan Jews just despised one another. But Jesus came to even love the people that no one... Listen, the Jews despised them, but Jesus says, I'll love them. And what about number seven? Jesus came, watch, to you and me. You see, I'm telling you, maybe you consider yourself a cut above. Maybe that's okay if you've got that self-evaluation. Maybe you can say, preacher, I'm not a shepherd. And I'm not an educated, illiterate somebody like you talked about this morning. Okay, that's fine. However you view yourself, but however you picture yourself is, you can't get around this, that Jesus still came and died for you. It doesn't matter how you think about yourself. Listen, it doesn't matter if you're rich, you're poor, you're middle class. It doesn't matter. You're all going to come to heaven the same way through the blood of Jesus Christ. There is no exception to that rule. Religion doesn't get you to heaven. Baptism doesn't get you to heaven. Pure thoughts doesn't get you to heaven. There's only one way. Jesus says, I am that way. Amen. Why did Jesus come to the shepherds? We tried to answer that question. Maybe I'll let the Bible answer that question better than me. In John chapter 1, verse 26, Jesus answers that question. John answered them saying, I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom you know not. He it is who cometh after me is preferred before me, whose shoe latchet I am not worthy to unloose. Now watch this. These things which done in Barthababa beyond Jordan where John was baptizing, and the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, I love this. Look at this. Behold the Lamb of God. You know why He came to the shepherds? Because He was the Lamb. He was your perfect Lamb. You see, what these shepherds would do, come on, they would raise these lambs for sacrifice. And all of these lambs that was out in that midnight field that time was nothing going to be but to shed their blood for sacrifices. And then John records for us here, John the Baptist says, oh, crowd and the multitudes. Then he says this to the multitudes. Look at this. Behold the Lamb. You see, He came to the shepherds because Jesus came as a lamb. Wow. What a story. If it wasn't in the Bible, we might not even appreciate what we just heard. At nearly 6'6", weighing 300 pounds, he was a very big man, to say the least. He was from Boston, the 9th generation of Puritan stock. He entered the Episcopalian ministry and he pastored in Philadelphia and in Boston. His sermons were often criticized for lack of doctrine. Nevertheless, he was for that day considered one of America's great preachers. His delivery came in lightning bursts. He felt he had more to say. Watch this. He felt he had more to say than time to say it. Amen. I know what he's talking about. While at the Philadelphia's Holy Trinity Church, he visited the Holy Land. On December the 24th of 1865, traveling by horseback from Jerusalem, he attended a five-hour Christmas Eve service at the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. He was very deeply moved by what he saw. He would write these words, "I remember standing in the old church in Bethlehem, close to the spot where Jesus was born, when the whole church was ringing hour after hour with hymns of praise to God, how again and again it seemed as if I could hear the voices I knew so well, telling each other of the wonderful night of the Savior's birth." 3 years later, as he prepared for Christmas season of 1867, he wanted to compose the original Christmas hymn for the children to sing during one of their annual programs. Recalling his special night in Bethlehem a few years ago, he wrote a little hymn of 5 stanzas and handed the words to his organist, a man by the name of Lewis Reeder. And he says, "Lewis, why not write a new tune for my poem? If it is a good tune, I will name it after you." Lewis struggled with his assignment, complaining of no inspiration. Finally, on the night before the Christmas program, he awoke with music ringing in his soul. He jotted down the melody and went back to sleep. The next day, a group of 6 Sunday school teachers and 36 children seeing for the very first time and sing this little song. When you open your hymn books, you will notice at the top of the page that the song is attributed to Phillips Brooks, over 300 pounds, over 6 foot tall. And he wrote these familiar words, "O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark streets shining the everlasting light." I like this part. "The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. O little town of Bethlehem." You see, this story is all centered on Jesus. And then it should be, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world." If he can take away the world's sins, I will assuredly say, he can take your sins away. My question to you on this December Sunday morning, do you know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? If there's any doubt where you would spend eternity, now would be the time to get that settled before it's eternally too late. Can I tell you something that you know? Life is too short to be uncertain about where you'll spend eternity. Preacher, I have heard that all my life. You don't need to go on about that. Well, okay. I'll finish by telling you this. I still believe that all men need to hear the gospel one more time. Because my job is to never assume that everybody here knows the Christ that I talked about this morning. There could be somebody that's just on the verge and they just need a little push. This morning I'm giving you that little push. Would you try him? Would you confess him? Would you ask Jesus in your heart? Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to present a simple story in a simple manner. Father, we thank you for the time that you have given me. And I pray, Father, that we could look at this and enjoy and at peace together this Christmas story more and more as the years go by. Lord, I am quite certain that everybody's heard this before, and I know that. But Lord, I just know this, that everybody needs to hear who you are and that you alone take away the sins of the world. Father, it is not in the preacher that can save a soul. It's not in the denomination that can take someone to heaven. Father, it is you and you alone. Father, I just pray as we just pause just a moment. Just a moment. To give you the praise and glory that you so rightfully deserve. In this auditorium, in this moment, I wonder if there'd be anybody that would say, "Preacher, I just don't know. I just don't know whether or not I have been fully saved by the blood of the Lamb of God. I just don't know. Preacher, I've been to churches. I've done all the activities. I've said all the words, but I just don't know if I'm Bible saved, if I'm ready for eternity." Father, if there's just one person in this room that just does not know, I pray, Lord, that they would not leave this place without understanding that. Would you stand with me all over the room? If God so lead on any matter, would you be diligent to the Spirit of God?